أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط صدق الله العظيم.
نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سيقول السفهاء من الناس ما ولاهم عن قبلتهم التي كانوا عليها قل لله المشرق والمغرب يهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم وكذلك جعلناكم أمة وسطا لتكونوا شهداء على الناس ويكون الرسول عليكم شهيدا وما جعلنا القبلة التي كنت عليها إلا لنعلم من يتبع الرسول ممن ينقلب على عقبيه وإن كانت لكبيرة إلا على الذين هدى الله وما كان الله ليضيع إيمانكم إن الله بالناس لرؤوف رحيم قد نرى تقلب وجهك في السماء فلنولينك قبلة ترضاها فول وجهك شطر المسجد الحرام وحيثما كنتم فولوا وجوهكم شطره وإن الذين أوتوا الكتاب ليعلمون أنه الحق من ربهم وما الله بغافل عما يعملون صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ربنا ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه آمين يا رب العالمين. In the coming two sections of Surah Al-Baqarah, that is the 17th and the 18th, the main subject which is discussed is tahweelul qibla, the change in the direction of the qibla. Sayaqulu sufaha'u minan nas. Now the fools among the people will say, ma wallahum an qiblatihim allati kanu 'alayha. What turned them from the qibla, the direction which they were facing in their prayers previously? قُلْ لِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. Say to them, to Allah belong all the east, the west. The east and west both belong to Allah. يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. He guides to whom He wishes to the straight path. Now the same words which appeared previously, لِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبِ فَإِنَّمَا تُوَلُّوا فَسَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. Those words are repeated here because when there was a change in the Qibla, the Jews especially made it a scandal. They made a very big issue out of it. Till that time, because after the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina, he ordered the Muslims to face towards Jerusalem while praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Jews thought that at least they are our camp followers. They are facing the same Qibla, the sacred place of ours. That is the sacred place for us. Our center, our spiritual center. If they are facing towards it, although he has claimed to be a prophet, to be a messenger of Allah, but they have actually accepted, you know, in some way, at least partially, our own traditions. But when there was change, for about 16 months, this was the condition. Muslims were praying, facing towards Jerusalem. But then came the ayat, which we shall be reading presently, inshallah, very soon. And then there was the change of Qibla towards the Masjid al-Haram, which is at Makkah. So now they raised hue and cry. What type of a prophet he is? His Qibla changes. What happened to the prayers of 16 months? If that was the wrong place, that was the wrong direction, and this is the correct direction, it means that the prayers of 16 months have been lost, gone without any avail. And what about those who died during this period? People who are living, they can, you know, in some way or the other, they can compensate. But who have already died, what will happen to them? So it became a very big issue. That is why Quran is also, you know, starting the discussion in a very unusual manner. فَيَقُولُ السُّفَهَاءُ مِنَ النَّاسِ مَا وَاللَّهُ مَنْ قِبْلَتِهِمُ الَّتِي كَانُوا عَلَيْهَا. The word, you know, sufaha, that is very unusual for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to use. But you know, it was the need of the time. The situation was such that demanded that it should be dealt with an iron hand. سَيَقُولُ السُّفَهَاءُ مِنَ النَّاسِ مَا وَاللَّهُ مَنْ قِبْلَتِهِمُ الَّتِي كَانُوا عَلَيْهَا قُلْ لِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ. First answer, this is not a very important issue which you have made out of it. It's a trivial issue. This Qibla doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is confined and limited to some one direction. It's only, you know, for the ummah, so that there should be harmony, there should be uniformity and nothing else. Otherwise, east, west, north, south, all the directions belong to Allah. أَيْنَ مَا تُوَلُّ فَسَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Whomsoever he wishes, he guides to the right path. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. And in this way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have made you, O Muslims, the best ummah, the intermediary ummah, or the most justly balanced ummah. This ummah, wasata, it can be translated in three ways. Because a thing which is in middle is the best. So the best ummah. Kuntum khayra ummatin uhlidat linnas. We shall read this ayah in Surah Al Imran. Khayra ummatin. So maybe the same meaning is of here also. Kuntum khayra ummatin. وَلَقَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. In this way, we have now declared you to be the best ummah, or the intermediary ummah. Now you will be the link between the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the whole of the humanity. Up till now, there were two links in the chain of risala or messengerhood. The message of Allah, wahi, came from Allah to Jibreel, from Jibreel to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now from Muhammad to the whole of humanity, this ummah is the link. It will carry the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is destined for the whole of humanity, to the humanity at large. So now you are the intermediary ummah. Ummatan wasatan, litakunu shuhada. And then the most justly balanced ummah, wasat, in between the two extremes. So balanced. And this, you know, changing of the Qibla is a symbol that the former Muslim Ummah has been deposed from this position, and now you, O the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, have been installed in that position for all times to come till the end of this world. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. So that you should become the witnesses over the humanity at large. وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. And the Rasul, the Messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he should become a witness over you. By preaching to you, by communicating and conveying to you the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through words as well as deeds, examples, practical examples. He has communicated and conveyed the message of Allah to you. You have to convey it to the humanity at large. And on the Day of Judgment, the Prophet will stand up and say and testify, O Allah, your guidance that came to me, I had conveyed to them. In the same manner, you will be required to stand and testify that, O Allah, your guidance that came to us through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we had conveyed that guidance to the whole humanity. And if you fail to do so, you will be brought to the book. You will be held responsible. Because if people go astray, If you have conveyed the message and then they go astray, they are responsible. But if you have not at all conveyed the message, then you are first to blame that you have not done your duty. This is, you know, a very serious problem to ponder upon, that this is a very big responsibility of the Muslim Ummah. لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا وَمَا جَعَلْنَا الْقِبْلَةَ الَّتِي كُنْتَ عَلَيْهَا. And we didn't declare that Qibla on which you were, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for 16 months. We declared, or we recognized that Qibla. Why? إِلَّا لِنَعْلَمَ مَنْ يَتَّبِعُ الرَّسُولَ مِمَّنْ يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَهِ. We did so only to differentiate and distinguish those who followed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who followed the messenger, who obeyed the messenger of Allah, from those who went back on their heels. Now what's the meaning? Because the Muhajireen, the people of Makkah, who were the first Muslims, they loved Kaaba very much. Because that was, so to say, we can say that was a national monument also. They were the progeny of Ibrahim, and Ibrahim built this house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they were doing Hajj during the Jahiliyyah also, before Islam also, although many things wrong were added to the rites and rituals of Hajj, many things which were essential were diminished from them. But you know, still this was going on. It was a national place for them, national monument for them. So now when they were asked after Hijrah, now you have to face to Jerusalem. It was a testing for them. If they really obeyed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not. If they had the love of their ancestral, you know, monument, then they would not have prayed towards, facing towards Jerusalem. So that was a test to distinguish those who really obeyed and followed the messenger of Allah and from those who went back on their heels. مِمَّا يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَهِ وَإِنْ كَانَتْ لَكَبِيرَةً. And surely it was a very big trial, very hard test to which the Muslims from Mecca were put. إِلَّا عَلَى الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهِ. Except on those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيْزِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. And Allah is not going to let the prayers of the Muslims go in waste, because prayers are the most essential thing. As-salatu imaduddin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to let the iman, the faith of the Muslims go in waste. لَيُزِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِالنَّاسِ لَرَوْفُ الرَّحِيمِ. Those who prayed towards Jerusalem, when the command of the Prophet was to face towards that Qibla, well, the prayers were okay. They were accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were genuine. They are not lost whatsoever. Because it was under the command of the Rasul of Allah. Hence, now the command is towards Kaaba. So now you have to pray towards Kaaba. And now this is the testing, now for whom? Supposedly, Abdullah ibn Salam radiallahu ta'ala, he was a Jew. And he was an alim, a very learned person, a rabbi of the Jews. He embraced Islam. Now when he had to face towards Kaaba, and he was now having his back towards Jerusalem, it was a test for him whether he has really accepted Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Islam and Quran, or there is some, you know, degree of sort of weakness of his faith. It was a test. So it was a two-way test. When the Muslims were ordered to face towards Jerusalem, it was a test for the people of the Makkah. When they were commanded to face towards Makkah, it was a test for especially the Jews. If someone of them had accepted Islam, it was a big trial and test for him, that he is now doing his back towards Jerusalem and facing towards Makkah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِالنَّاسِ لَرَوْفُ الرَّحِيمِ. Verily Allah Ta'ala is with the people. He is very much merciful and kind. قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have been seeing turning of your face towards the sky. He was waiting for the final commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change the direction of Qibla. He was expecting it. He wished that the direction be changed, and he was waiting. So in waiting he was, you know, seeing towards the sky when Jibreel comes. قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا. So we shall turn your face towards the direction which you like, which will please you. فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. So now turn your face towards the direction of the Masjid al-Haram. This is the mosque around the Baytullah. This is Masjid al-Haram, the sacred mosque. وَحَيْسُ مَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَ. And wherever you may be, O Muslims. What does it mean? It is not a personal command for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only. It's for the whole of Ummah. Wherever you may be, حَيْسُ مَا كُنْتُمْ, O Muslims, فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَ. So turn your faces towards Kaaba, towards Masjid al-Haram, while praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ لَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ. And verily and surely, people who were given the book, they know it for sure that this is the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They knew it, that the real Qibla was Kaaba. That real direction, the first house that was built for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was at Bakka. إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكًا وَهُدًى لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Because everybody knew it and everybody knows it, that Jerusalem actually as a city was founded by Solomon alayhi salatu wasalam, Hazrat Sulaiman. About 2000 years or at least 1500 years after Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. There was no Jerusalem at the time of Ibrahim. So actually, this was the first house, Kaabatullah. And it was built originally by Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. But secondly, it was renewed by Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam, which we have read in the previous sections. So that this house is the older house. And you know the prophets, Moses alayhi salatu wasalam, in which direction he was praying. When there was no Jerusalem. The temple of Solomon was going to be built at least 500 years after him. So which direction he was praying at that time? So actually the old and the ancient Qibla was this very Qibla. So people who were knowledgeable of the Book of Allah, who really knew the Torah, they knew it. وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ لَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ. Verily and surely, those who are given the book, they know that this is the truth from their Lord. وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ أَمَّا يَعْمَلُونَ. And Allah is not unaware of what they are doing. وَلَيْنَ أَتَيْكَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ بِكُلِّ آيَةٍ. And if you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bring forth before these people of the book all the proofs, all the arguments, مَا تَبِعُوا قِبْلَتَكْ, they are not going to follow and accept your Qibla. وَمَا أَنْتَ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَهُمْ. And now that the truth has been dawned unto you, and the commandment from Allah has come unto you, now you cannot follow their Qibla. You can also not follow their Qibla in any case. وَمَا بَعْضُهُمْ بِتَابِعٍ بَعْضُهُمْ قِبْلَةَ بَعْضٍ. And some of them cannot follow the Qibla of the others. Because although Jerusalem was sacred for both Christians and the Jews, but in the temple of Solomon itself, for the Jews it was the western corner which was more holy. And for the Christians it was the eastern part of the temple which was more holy. Because you know Hazrat Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam took to itikaf in the eastern corner of the temple of Solomon, of the Haikal. So that is why you know between among them also, although they agreed on Jerusalem, on the temple, but in the temple there was a difference of opinion about the direction. When in the temple, when we are in Kaaba, in Masjid al-Haram, all are facing towards Kaaba. But if even in Masjid al-Haram somebody is facing towards east and somebody is facing towards west, now what is it? The difference is very apparent. This would have been very apparent. It is not so. In the Masjid al-Haram, we all face towards Kaaba in circles. But in Jerusalem, in the temple of Solomon, the Christians were facing towards east and the Jews were facing towards west. So they didn't have even one Qibla. Although the house, although the temple of Solomon, that was common to them. So that is the meaning of this ayah. وَلَيْنِ أَتَيْتَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ بِكُلِّ آيَةٍ مَا تَبِعُوا قِبْلَتَكْ. Even all the proofs you may produce before them, they are not going to follow your Qibla. وَمَا أَنْتَ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَهُمْ. Now you can also not follow their Qibla. You have followed their Qibla for 16 months. But now the command has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. So you cannot follow their Qibla. And they can follow the Qibla of each other also. وَمَا بَعْضُهُمْ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَةَ بَعْضٍ. وَلَئِنِ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاهُمْ بَعْدَ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِنَّكَ إِذًا لَّمِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And if you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and if you, O Muslims, you follow their wishes after that this truth has, the real knowledge has been communicated to you, that this has come to you, then you will be from the unjust people. You will also be from zalimeen. الذين آتيناهم الكتاب يعرفونه كما يعرفون أبناءهم. To those whom we gave the book, they recognize it or recognize him. يعرفونه can be for Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. It can be for Kaaba. It can be for Quran. يعرفونه, the pronoun who, can point towards either Muhammad, person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They recognize the person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he is the last messenger of Allah, about whom there were the prophecies in Torah and Injil. They recognize that this Qibla is the real Qibla, the ancient Qibla, the old Qibla, the original Qibla. They recognize that this Quran is the book of Allah, is the word of Allah. الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابَ يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاهُمْ. وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِّنْهُمْ لَيَكْتُمُونَ الْحَقَّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. But a group among them, some of them, they are hiding and concealing the truth knowingly. They know it, that they are hiding the truth. The truth is in their knowledge, and intentionally they are concealing and hiding it. الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكَ فَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُمْتَرِينَ. But you know, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and O Muslims, this is the truth from your Lord, so none of you should be one of those who go into doubt. You must have full conviction that this is the real Qibla and this is the ancient Qibla, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has restored you to the original Qibla. وَلِكُلِّ وِجْهَةٌ هُوَ مُوَلِّيهَا. For every nation, for every community, there is a direction towards which they face. فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. So, O Muslims, you vie with each other in pursuing whatever is good. Oh, you should be after virtue. You should compete with each other towards virtues and charity and whatever is good. أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يَعْتَبِكُمُ اللَّهِ. Wherever you will be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will gather you. جَمِيعًا, all of you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is powerful for everything. He can do whatever he likes. وَمِنْ حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. And from wherever you start intending to pray, you turn your face in the direction of the Masjid al-Haram. وَإِنَّهُ لَلْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. You see here how it is being repeated, how many times it is being repeated, the emphasis being put on it. And in the between the lines you can read what was the background, what was, you know, the scandal which was produced by the Jews and the propaganda against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that can be very easily seen between the lines. وَمِنْ حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. From wherever you start, you begin, you want to pray, you stand to pray, turn your face towards the sacred mosque. وَإِنَّهُ لَلْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. And verily it is the truth, it is the real Qibla from your Lord. وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. And Allah is not unaware of what you are doing. وَمِنْ حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. See how it is being repeated. وَحَيْثُ مَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَهُ. From wherever you stand for praying, turn your face towards this sacred mosque. And all of you, O Muslims, wherever from you stand to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, turn your faces towards the sacred masjid. لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَيْكُمْ حُجَّةٌ. So that there should be no argument against you for the people. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْهُمْ. Except for those who are the unjust among them. Now what's the meaning of this part of this ayah? Because had not the Qibla changed, the knowledgeable persons who had the real knowledge among the Jews, they would have argued against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if he was the real and the last prophet, he would have turned to the real and the ancient Qibla. If he has not done it, he is not the real prophet. That would have been the argument against you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had not the direction of this Qibla been changed. Now, whosoever is arguing against you, they are the unjust people, they are the illiterate people, they are the those people who know nothing. So you don't care about them. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْهُمْ فَلَا تَخْشَوْهُمْ وَخْشَوْنِي. Don't care for them. Don't have any fear of them. You should fear me. وَلَيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتِي عَلَيْكُمْ. And this is, I have done this. I have changed this direction of this qibla so that I should complete all the blessings on you. All the things, you know, they have to be completed. This deen of Allah is to be completed with you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for all times to come. So you have to do everything. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَحْتَدُونَ. And so that you, O Muslims, you are on the right path, you are guided. And you reach the final destination of success. كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ. As we have now sent in you. Now just recall that prayer of Ibrahim and Ismail when they were raising the walls of Kaaba. رَبَّنَا وَبَعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is declaring, this is actually the advent of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is really the prayer of Ibrahim and Ismail, which has taken this form, the messengerhood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is in response to the prayer of Ibrahim and Ismail that we have sent our messenger Muhammad amongst you. كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْكُمْ. And he is from amongst you, رَسُولًا مِّنْكُمْ. يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِنَا. He is reciting unto you our ayat. وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ. Purifying your souls. وَيُعَلَّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. And teaching you the book as well as the wisdom. وَيُعَلَّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. And he is teaching you what you were not knowing before. فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. So you remember me. Always keep me in remembrance. أَذْكُرْكُمْ. I will remember you. وَاشْكُرُونِي. It's very beautiful. You know, the relationship between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the abd, the bondsman, is bilateral. فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. You remember me, I will remember you. إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. If you help Allah, Allah will help you. There is in a hadith a very beautiful expression. If you come towards Allah walking, Allah will come towards you running. If you come towards Allah the amount of a hand, Allah will come to you the length of an arm. If you remember Allah in your heart, Allah will also remember you in his heart. And if you mention Allah in some gathering, Allah will mention you in a much higher, a better gathering, the gathering of the angels. خُدَا خُدْ مَحْمِيرِ مَحْفِ الْبُودِ اَنْدَرْ لَا مَكَانْ خُسْرَوْ مُحَمَّدْ سَمِ مَحْفِ الْبُودِ شَبْ جَائَ كَمَنْ بُودَمْ. In that mahfil, in that gathering of the malaikatul muqarrabun, Allah mentions the persons who mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in some gatherings. So it's a bilateral relationship. فَاسْكُرُونِي أَسْكُرْكُمْ وَاشْكُرُونِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ. And be thankful to me, be grateful to me, and don't be ungrateful towards me. Now here the first part of this surah al-Mubarakah ends. In this first part I told you the basic address was towards the former Muslim Ummah, either directly or indirectly. Although in the last portions there was mention, there were some things said towards Muslims also. There was some mention, very trivial mention of the people of Makkah, of the pagan Arabs also. Because you know the division in the Quran, you won't find that it is very hard and fast. The two parts are interlocking with each other. Now the address is directly to the Muslim Ummah. And please note before we proceed, that this we can analyze, that there are four threads of four subjects which are wound together just as you have in a rope, so that they are interwoven with each other. Although all the threads are continuous, but when you know you have two or three or four strands and you wind them and you make them in the rope, if they are of different colors, red and blue and green and white, these colors will appear to be interrupted. They will be not continuous. You will see the red color and then the green, then the white and then the blue and so on. But you know, if you open away and you separate the strands from one from other, now you will find that all the strands are continuous. So what are those four strands? Number one, now the address to the Muslim Ummah about Sharia. And Sharia comprises of two parts, the ibadat, the modes of worship, and the muamalat, the affairs of the Muslim community. This is halal, this is haram, this is permissible, this is forbidden. In social affairs especially, in nikah and talaq, etc., etc., you'll find. This thing is haram. Sharab, about sharab and masir, you know the all these commandments will start, and the blueprint of the sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be prepared within this second part of this surah Al-Baqarah. So two strands are of sharia. One of ibadat, Sawm and Hajj, they will be discussed. Salat will be discussed. And number two of Muamalat, nikah and talaq and marriage and separation and divorce and so on, and things, eating which is permissible and things which are forbidden to eat, etc., etc. And the other two strands, the two parts of jihad fi sabilillah, infaq fi sabilillah, qital fi sabilillah, to spend your mal. And this, you know, is the jihad bil mal. Jahidu fi sabilillah bi amwalikum wa anfusikum. Jihad with your properties, your belongings. This is infaq fi sabilillah. Then the jihad with your bodies, the final stage is qital fi sabilillah, going to war for the cause of Allah. So these four strands, the ibadat, the muamalat, the infaq fi sabilillah, and the jihad qital fi sabilillah, they are interwoven with one each other. And these will be, some issue will be discussed, then the second will be taken, then the third will be taken, then the first might be again discussed, then the second might be discussed. So they are continuous, but you know they will appear to be interrupted. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu ista'inu bis sabri was salah. Note this ayah. In the very beginning, the same verse with which the fifth section of this surah ended. That section which was for dawah to Bani Israel. Ya Bani Israel, askuru ni'mati allati anamtu alaykum wa afu bi ahdi ufi bi ahdikum wa iyaya farhabun. And the last ayah was, wasta'inu bis sabri was salah. Wa innaha lakabiratun illa ala al-khashi'in allazina yadhunnuna annahum mulaqu rabbihim wa annahum ilayhi raji'un. Take help and take Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala support. Fasta'inu bis sabri was salah. And two things are the medium of the support of from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can get the support and help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through patience and perseverance and through salah and prayer. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ista'inu bis sabri was salah. O you who believe, seek help in patience and perseverance and prayer. Inna Allah ma'as sabirin. Verily, Allah is with the patient ones. People who show perseverance, Allah's help will be with them. وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ. Now because a very big mission, a very difficult mission was assigned. Now you have to be the witnesses over whole of mankind. And this will entail risks for you. And you might be killed for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ. From the very beginning, in the very beginning, it's a warning. Don't think. It's a very simple route. It's a very plain road, a plain path to tread. No, there are difficulties. There are going to be tests and tribulations. You will be tried in every way. Your sincerity will be tested. So this is the forewarning to the Muslim Ummah. And here the Muslim Ummah is being addressed to for the first time in the Quran. وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ. Don't say about them who are killed in the way of Allah that they are dead. بَلَحْيَاوْ وَلَا كِلَّا تَشْرُونَ. No, they are living, but you cannot perceive it. It's beyond your perception. But they are living, they are not dead. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. And we shall certainly and surely test you with something from fear. You'll find fear. وَالْجُوعِ and hunger. وَنَقْسِ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ and losses in the property as well as lives and fruits. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. O Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, give glad tidings to those who show patience and perseverance. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ. Who are they? Who are those sabreen? الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ. Who, when afflicted with calamity, قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. They respond by saying that we belong to Allah and to Him we shall return. We are His property. We belong to Him. He can do anything He likes to us. All that He does to us, all that is from Him, is acceptable to us. He is our Lord. Huwa Maulana. He is our Lord. If He has decided this for me, well, this is good for me. Although it might appear to be bad for me, injurious for me. It might be, I might think that it is causing any loss to me, any pain to me. But it is good for me if it has been ordained for me by my Lord, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَّبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ. They are the people on whom the blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come and His mercy will descend. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. And they are the rightly guided ones. They will reach the final destination of success and rust and fall and fala. إِنَّ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ. Now you know, because with Ibrahim's mention in the 15th section, there was the mention of the building of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Baytullah. Then there was the mention of Tawaf and Ruku and Sujood and Itikaf and Maqam Ibrahim. So in the holy places there, these two were remaining. So a mention has been made of these two also. Inna Safa wal Marwata min Sha'airillah. Verily, surely the mounts of Safa and Marwa are also from the emblems of Allah, symbols of Allah, Sha'air. Emblems, symbols, signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَنْ حَجَّ الْبَيْتَ وَاِعْتَمَرَ فَلَا جُنَاهَ عَلَيْهِ يَتَّوَّفَ بِهِمَا. So whosoever makes Hajj or Umrah of the Bayt of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there will be no sin on him if he also circumambulates both of them. He is doing Tawaf, but you know this is not Tawaf, this is Sa'i. Going from Safa to Marwa, one. And returning from Marwa to Safa, two. So all seven. So actually it's walking, and in a part of it it's running, but it is not circumambulation. Sa'i it is called. But here, you know, Quran has used the same word Tawaf, because you are going from this to that and returning back to the original mount of Safa. So it can be said to be Safa, Tawaf, but actually this is Sa'i. And in the Manasik ki Hajj, you know, it's called Sa'i. وَمَنْ تَتَوَّى خَيْرًا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ شَاكِرٌ عَلِيمٌ. Or whosoever does any good deed voluntarily. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always appreciative of anybody's good deed. And He is definitely knowing. He knows every good deed of every person. Now there is a reference again to the Jews. And this is going to be the last place in this surah where a reference has been made to the Jews. Because they concealed all the facts about the advent of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, in the last part of the 16th section, with which the first part of the Quran ended, we had the ayah, but because we were ending that session, so we couldn't pay attention, full attention, due attention to that ayah. وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ كَتَمَ شَهَادَةً عِنْدَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. Who is more cruel, more unjust than that person who conceals and hides a testimony from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is with Him. You are having a testimony from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are hiding it. You are keeping it back. You are concealing it. So this is the biggest injustice. This is the biggest act, you know, of evil that a man can be expected to commit. مَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ كَتَمَ شَهَادَةً عِنْدَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. Now actually we may say that these three ayat or four ayat, they are giving the details of the same ayah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُمُونَ مَا أَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالْهُدَىٰ. Definitely, surely those who conceal and hide what we have sent down, مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ, clear signs and clear teachings, وَالْهُدَىٰ and guidance, مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا بَيَّنَّاهُ لِلنَّاسِ فِي الْكِتَابِ. After we made them very clear in our book for the people, أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّاعِنُونَ. They are the people on whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself curses. And all the cursers, all those who curse, they also curse them. أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّاعِنُونَ. Those who have this, that testimony, that knowledge, that guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down in his book, but people who have that book, they conceal that testimony, actually they are getting the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and curse of all the cursers. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ تَعْمُوا. There is an exception. Except those who repent. وَأَصْلَحُوا. And relent towards them. وَأَصْلَحُوا وَبَيَّنُوا. Those who make tawbah, who return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who repent, فَأَصْلَحُوا. And then they rectify their attitude, وَبَيَّنُوا. And then they explain and make clear whatever was there in the book. أُولَٰئِكَ أَتُوبُ عَلَيْهِمْ. They are the people on whom I will relent towards them. وَأَنَا التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. And I am the one who relents towards people who make tawbah and who are repenting in the real sense. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارٌ. On the contrary, those who committed kufr, who disbelieved, who belied the truth, وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارٌ, and died in the same condition, died in kufr, died as kafirs. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. They are the people on whom there is the curse of Allah and all the angels and all the people. They are having for them the, all the curses from Allah as well as the angels as well as the, all the men. وَإِلَىٰ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. They will remain in that, dwell in that curse forever. لَا يُخَفَّفُ عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابُ. Neither the punishment or chastisement will be reduced for them, diminished for them. وَلَا هُمْ يُنْذَرُونَ. Nor they will be given any respite. وَإِلَٰهُكُمْ إِلَٰهُ وَاحِدٌ. Your Lord, your God is one God. لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا هُوَ. There is no God except Him. الرَّحْمَٰهُ الرَّحْمَٰنُ الرَّحِيمُ. And He is all compassionate, all merciful, most beneficent. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَالْفُلْكِ الَّتِي تَجْرِي فِي الْبَحْرِ بِمَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسِ. Now this is a very important ayah of the Quran. And this actually, I have given it a name, Ayatul Ayat. Because this one ayah contains reference to so many physical phenomena. These physical phenomena which Quran declares as signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These skies, these heavens, this moon, this sun, the alternation of the day and night, creation of heavens and earth, and this rain, all that the greenery this earth usually gets after the rain, and so on. Everything, you know, is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sign of His wisdom, sign of His authority, sign of His power. So actually all these things are signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find in various Makki surahs, each one of these signs is discussed separately in ayat. But here in one ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gathered so many physical phenomena as His signs. So it is ayatul ayat, the one ayah which has comprised so many ayat and signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Surely in the creation of heavens and the earth, وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ, and the difference or alternation of the night and the day, وَالْفُلْكِ الَّتِي تَجْرِي فِي الْبَحْرِ بِمَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسِ, and in the ships that float in the rivers and the sea, with the material which is beneficial, بِمَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسِ, which is beneficial for people, وَمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مِنْ مَاءٍ, and in the water that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down from the sky, فَأَحْيَا بِهِ الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا, and revived the earth after it had died. It was dead, because when there is no greenery on the earth, it is like a dead earth. There is nothing, no signs of life. But when there is rain, there are all signs of life, you know, there is greenery. And you know, the insects also appear, birds also come. Life, you know, in all the form now becomes very evident and apparent. فاحيا به الارض بعد موتها and he made you know the earth again living after it had been dead وبث فيها من كل دابة and he has spread in it all the moving creatures all the animals all the things that he has created والسحاب المسخر وتصريف الرياح and in the changing of the winds direction of the wind is changing from this direction to that direction والسحاب المسخر and this cloud which is you know subservient and this is between بين السماء والأرض this is floating between the earth and the sky لا آيات لقوم يعقلون in each one of them there are signs for people who have understanding who can infer from these who can understand them every sign you know is a clear proof of Allah's existence of Allah being almighty of Allah being the all knowing all the attributes great attributes the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala they are manifest in these physical phenomena that every man can see with his own eyes wa min an-nas man yattakhidhu min dunillahi andadan yuhibbunahum ka hubbillah and there are among the people who accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala other things and make them rivals to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they become loving them with the love which was due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala you know this is a philosophical ayah of the Quran because you know and let me mention here Dr. Rafiuddin he's a very big scholar and he explained the philosophy of self of Allama Iqbal in a very philosophical book of his that is the ideology of the future the main theme of the philosophy is that in man there is an urge for love he wants to love someone something some idea some ideology this is the basic urge in every human being so much so that for this love of his he can sacrifice and he is ready to sacrifice even his life because the modern psychologists they tell us that the most potent instincts in man are the preservation of the self and the preservation of the species you want to live you want to save yourself this is the most potent instinct in every living being but in men we find men have sacrificed their lives for ideologies how many people laid down their lives for the communist revolution in Russia how many people sacrificed their lives at the command of Hirohito the king of Japan they committed harakiri they committed suicide at the command of the emperor at the command because they thought that our emperor is a god also a manifestation of god god incarnate so out of love for him they committed harakiri and that was a special form of suicide they used to cut their own abdomen with their own hands with a knife starting from the lower part of the abdomen till the chest the whole person doing it himself killing himself so actually he has decided he has inferred and is proved that the most basic instinct in human beings is which differentiates them from all animals because the most potent animal instinct is to preserve himself but here we find that man sacrifices his own life not only his own life his progeny for the sake of some idea ideology some philosophy some people for their nation some people for their country some people for their honor some people for you some ideology from communism and so on it means there is an inherent urge to love something in every human being this inherent urge of love was basically produced in us for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala but people who don't reach that place who can't comprehend Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who have not recognized who didn't have the marfa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now they place somebody else something else in its place and they start loving him or that idea with the intensity with which they should have loved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that is the basic reason of shirk sometimes it is the country my country I am sacrificing my life for my country my nation I am sacrificing I have dedicated myself to my nation my religion my philosophy my ideology my revolution so actually all this was to be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But people, out of ignorance, when they couldn't reach the concept and the marfa and the understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they place something else at that place. Because if you are very hungry, you eat everything then. Even haram can be eaten at that time. Even the dead flesh, the flesh of a dead animal can be eaten. Because the urge to eat is so strong in you, that if the good food is not available, you are eating the very foul food. In the same way, if you, this urge of love, it is not attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will somehow attach with something else. And that thing will become your God now. Either it is watan, or it is qaum, nation, or country, or some idea, or some ideology. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. There are from among people who take or make something rival to Allah, and they start loving them, loving that thing, or loving those things, just as they should have loved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, kahubbillah. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And those who have real faith, who have reached the iman, who have reached the gnosis of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have got the marfa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than anything. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Now this is the essence of iman. And this is the criterion on which we can assess ourselves. Is Allah more dear to us than our own lives? Is Allah more dear to us than our sons and daughters and parents or our wives? Is Allah more dear to us than all the wealth of the world? If the answer is yes, Allah is more dear to me than anything else, then it is iman. Thank God that you have the iman. And if anything is there which is more dear to you than Allah, then that is your God, not Allah. If you love wealth more than Allah, then Allah is your, then the wealth is your God, not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why the Prophet said, Tais abdud dinar wa abdud dirham. Woe to the bondsman of dirham and dinar. Because whosoever loves, you know, this wealth, dollar, more than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dollar should come, money should come, rupee should come. Whether it is coming from halal or haram, I don't care. It means it is more beloved to you. It's more dear to you than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you may be having the name of Abdul Rahman, but actually you are Abdul Dinar. You are Abdul Dirham. Ta'is Abdul Dinar wa Abdul Dirham. Woe to the Abdul Dinar and Abdul Dirham. A man who is a bondsman to Dinar and Dirham. So whosoever is most loved by you, he is actually your Lord, he is actually your God, and you are worshipping him. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And those who have real iman, they love Allah more than anything else. Let me quote here the ayah number 24 of Suratul Tawbah. قُلْ إِنْ كَانَ آبَاؤُكُمْ وَأَبْنَاؤُكُمْ وَإِخْوَانُكُمْ وَأَزْوَاجُكُمْ وَعَشِيرَتُكُمْ وَأَمْوَالٌ اقْتَرَفْتُمُوهَا وَتِجَارَةٌ تَخْشَوْنَ كَسَادَهَا وَمَسَاكِنُ تَرْضَوْنَهَا أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَجِهَادٍ فِي سَبِيلِهِ فَتَرَبَّصُوا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِهِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if your fathers and your brothers and your sons and your wives or spouses or your relatives and the wealth that you have gathered and the business about whose, you know, you are always fearing about some recession, and of the big buildings that you have built, which you very much like, if all these eight things are more dear to you than Allah and His Messenger and going to jihad for the cause of Allah, then go and wait till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares His final judgment, and Allah is not going to guide such rebellious type of people. Now this is actually the criterion of iman. So وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِذْ يَرَوْنَ الْعَذَابَ أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعَذَابِ. And only if these people who had committed sins, who have been unjust, who have done shirk, because this is the description of shirk, if they could see the azab is Yaron al-Azab, if they could see the moment, if they could visualize the time, when they will see the azab and the punishment and the chastisement, and they will clearly understand at that time, أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا, that all authority is with Allah, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعَذَابِ, and that Allah is very severe in punishment. These realities will dawn on them at that time. Only if it could dawn on them at this time, this would have been beneficial with them, for them. اِسْتَبَرَّ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا, when those who were followed, the leaders, the general public was following them. They may be religious leaders, they may be the political leaders who have given slogans to the public at large. When those people who were followed, they will disown them who were following them, barabul azab, and when they will see before their eyes the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fire of hell, wa taqatta'at bihimul asbab, and all the relations between them will all be broken and cut. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا, and at that time those people who were followers, who were following the leaders, the religious or the political leaders, they will say, لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا كَرَّةً, if there can be a returning for us to the world, the worldly life again, لَتَبَرَّى مِنْهُمْ كَمَا تَبَرَّوا مِنَّا, we will also sever all relations from them. We will disown our leaders, the religious as well as the political leaders, as they have disowned us today. كَذَلِكَ يُرِيهُمُ اللَّهُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ حَسَرَاتٍ عَلَيْهِمْ, in this manner Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show them all their deeds that they had done and committed in this world as regrets for them. Now they will be regretting. We followed them and they took us astray. We believed in them and they, you know, just took us away from the right path. But this will be regret only. There is no second returning to this world. This life is for once, and now the hereafter will be eternal. The result that will going to be to last forever. وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ, and they will not be able to come out of the fire. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم.
الله أكبر
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzim.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us. or call our toll-free number, 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together, we can make a difference.